Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Question and Answer from People in USA. And it is part of the General Discussion Series. It was presented in Dallas, Texas, USA on the 19th of February, 2012.
How's everyone going? That was a quick feeding, was it? Mary's going to join me for this part. Just because we wanted to give you the opportunity to ask any question you want, and some, we realised that some of those questions might be directed at Mary rather than myself, so I asked Mary to join me just in case there were some of your questions directed at her. Carolyn has listed a long list of questions, but there is one that I want to answer in our session while we're answering, yes, if we can.
Would you like to read it out?
If you'd like to.
Just sure. This one? This one?
Yeah.
How does the Holy Spirit function in our lives? Does it come only when we receive divine love and then it is within us to guide us through feelings? What is the difference in feeling between a spirit guide and the Holy Spirit?
Okay. So good question. Mm-hmm. Now could you read it with more expression?
Slow down. Okay.
Can you feel why you did it the other way?
I don't know.
You sort of, what do you feel when you're in front of people? Do you feel?
I feel great when I'm in front of people.
Yeah.
I'm in front of people all the time. I don't have any. I teach and I don't have a lot of. But if perhaps I'm now just in front of people mode, versus being like feeling about the question.
So you have an in front of people mode and a feeling mode.
I don't know. I'm just brainstorming. Who knows?
Yeah. And. Whenever we read anything for anybody, just a suggestion is that do it as if with some, allow yourselves to slow down, so that, because other people, you know the question,
mm-hmm.
other people do not know the
yeah.
question. So allow yourself to sort of slow down and express the question in a way that a person would be feeling it if you could. So,
okay.
Yeah. So.
And I actually am working through, I have a fear of wasting time.
That was the emotion.
And I have a fear of not being heard because my mom never let me
it's
finish.
It's the wasting time emotion that caused you to...
And so it's always like, you know, just get it all out. So I recognize that. I'm working through it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, well, let's...
So I don't have to do it again?
Yes.
Oh, I do.
but let's do it one question at a time.
Okay. How does the Holy Spirit function in our lives?
Okay, that is very
thank you.
God, the great oversoul of the universe, our mother, father, and our creator, basically, right? Here we are, one half of a complete soul. The other half of a complete soul, somewhere else. So if it is me, then that's my half connected to the two bodies, the spirit body and the physical body. In the case of my soulmate, my Mary Magdalene.
Yeah. We're on the wrong side though.
Oops, I'll just do it the other way around. Spirit body, Mary's. Physical body of Mary's. Firstly, God does not connect directly ever with our spirit body or our physical body.
Wow.
God doesn't ever connect directly to them. What God connects directly to is, so I'll just put a cross on that so you know it's not the case. What God connects directly to is our soul. And our soul is connected to our spirit body and physical body through cords. Through cords that conduct energy. But basically you could think of them as these bodies as robots under the soul's control. And the silver cord, which is the cord that connects the physical body to the soul, the physical body to the spirit body, is a cord that begins at the base of your brain and goes right down to the tailbone, the end of your tailbone, and involves all of your central nervous system and all of the nerves that go right up your spine. They're all the pathway through which the spirit body experiences the physical body, and therefore the soul experiences the physical body. So, is there any questions about that so far? No? Now, the role of the Holy Spirit is unique in the connection to us as individuals. The Holy Spirit is like a pipe, a conduit of energy, that when you long for divine love to flow into your soul, you long for love from God to flow into your soul, this Holy Spirit physically connects to your soul and allows the flow of the love coming from God. It's actually a substance, the love as well. It comes from God and flows through the cord, the Holy Spirit, into your soul. Now, the Holy Spirit can only connect to your soul under certain circumstances. Your soul must be in that moment in a condition of desire for God's love. And it must also be in a condition of truth in desire. In other words, the desire must be sincere for it to flow.
So not in a state of addiction or take me away from something.
Not wanting to take me away from something. Yep. Yep. All those things. Yeah. Now, when those conditions are present, the Holy Spirit, which is always around us, waiting for this connection to occur to every single individual in the universe, actually. What happens is it connects to us. You could liken it to connecting to your crown chakra or something like that, but the reality is it connects to your soul, not to your spirit body. And the Holy Spirit then becomes the conduit in order for love to flow. So if you think of love like water flowing into the soul, what happens is without the pipe connecting God to us, that love cannot flow. Now, in the first century, I said that there was a sin against the Holy Spirit. The sin against the Holy Spirit is denying its role and denying God to allow the connectivity between us and God. So, in other words, when we sin against the Holy Spirit, we are out of harmony with truth, and while we're in that place, we deny this connection. We put a block on the connection. While we are sinning against the Holy Spirit, there will never be any flow of this personal love from God. Now, God has a general love for all of her creatures and creations. That love continues no matter what we choose to do with our life, whether we choose to be the most evil person possible or the best person we can be without God, that love will continue to flow. And in the first century, I said, God made it rain upon the righteous and the unrighteous. He gave food to the righteous and the unrighteous. Right? And what I meant there was that there was this love that God has for all of us that's immaterial of our desire for it. And that often is, and we see the effects for it in our lives, whether we are good or bad. That's different from this particular desire. This is the desire for a personal relationship with God, which is very, very different than a generalized love. So this is a desire. It's a bit like myself and Mary, right? We can meet, interact, but I don't want to. I cannot really want to know her personally, right? But when I start to desire and know her personally, now we enter a different relationship. And that relationship is very special to the both of us. And every relationship we have with any person that we desire to come to know is unique, because the other person is unique, so therefore the relationship is quite unique. Now, our relationship with God is the most unique of all relationships, in the sense that God is this universal being with ultimate power who still wants to have a personal relationship with me. That's very different than Mary wanting a relationship with me. And it's through the Holy Spirit, and you could say, so if I drew it on this map, that thing there, the actual conduit, which is the pipe through which the love flows, that is the Holy Spirit. That's what I called the Holy Spirit in the first century. And you can actually see it when you are a spirit. You can actually see it as a columnar tube of light that connects the person with this unseen source. Does that make sense? You can't see the source, but you can see the pipe coming out of somewhere that you can't see, coming to the person.
But if what you're seeing is not actually a connection to the spirit body.
No, it's a connection to the soul.
To the soul, but yeah. You view it because you're viewing the person in the spirit form?
Remember that your spirit form and your physical form are contained within your soul. So your soul is an energy band, has an energy band around both bodies. So your soul is actually something that even a spirit cannot see, but it's a band of energy, which is you, your real you, your real nature, and the Holy Spirit connects to the real you. But often you see it as coming into, with the spirit form, you often see it coming somewhere in around the crown, what they now call the crown chakra, and you see this energy coming. Now, as soon as the person no longer longs for Holy love from God, it cuts off straight away. The pipe disappears. It's like it's not even there. And as soon as the person longs again for love in a sincere way, bang, it's back again. And so it's very interesting when you go to a Pentecostal church meeting, for example, if you're a spirit, because you'll see many people in the audience because of their love for God and their desire for God's love to enter them, you see many of them having these bands, but it's only very brief sometimes because of the different emotions in the person that turn the band back off again. And so you see all these shoots of light coming into the meeting, and that's what attracts many spirits, and many spirits come and feel quite attracted to that whole atmosphere. Unfortunately, some of those spirits then overcloak people on the earth and you get a bit of a mess happening, but the reality is that you can see these things happening when you're a spirit, yes?
You're saying that that's kind of an energetic connection there from the Holy Spirit to the soul body?
Yes, the Holy Spirit is an energy. It's a spirit. I called it a spirit,
mm-hmm.
An energy between God and the person who longs for God's love.
And I hear a sound all the time. Would that be like that connection? I've heard that there's
there
a sound
no
current.
There is no sound associated with this connection.
No sound associated.
No sound at all.
Okay.
Yep.
Oops.
Thank you.
Is the Holy Spirit then a tool that is used only for people up to the seventh sphere and people on earth?
What?
Or in the celestial, because they're one with God after the eighth sphere, then it's just kind of, it's everywhere.
Every celestial spirit has that connection permanently.
Permanently.
So out of every celestial spirit, when you see a celestial spirit, there will actually be this column of light coming into them that's permanent connection that never goes away. They never lose it after they become a celestial spirit. Once you become one with God, you're permanently connected to God, and therefore you're permanently connected to the Holy Spirit as a result. And for that reason, every celestial spirit has a permanent column coming from their soul to God, yeah. Whom they can't see, by the way. So they can't see God, but there's the column coming from God to them. Yeah.
Speaking slowly. I need to...
Don't worry about being so close. It's okay.
Okay. Yeah. I need a suggestion on how to... where and how to get into my soul and find this error and work on it. It has to do with cars. Since 2007, I've had five cars. I've had 3 accidents on January. I flipped a car over, could very well have taken my life.
Yeah.
Now I have a used car that's already in the shop.
Yeah.
I would love some assistance.
The spirits with you, Dana, are trying to get me off the subject of divine love and the flow of divine love into the soul.
Oh.
And which is interesting why they want to do that. So they want to keep you away from your connection with God. So can I go back to the connection with God?
Of course. Yeah. Of course. No, right. I just thought it was my turn.
That's okay.
Yeah. AJ, when you're talking about the Holy Spirit, it's not really a spirit in the way we think of spirits.
It's not a person.
It's never been an entity.
No.
It's a special connection. God is this little charger.
It's a column of energy through which love from God flows into the human soul. And actually transforms the human soul.
Got it. There are many spirits who like to portray themselves as the Holy Spirit.
Okay. Lots of spirits try to portray themselves as such.
Yes.
Yep.
So this is why a lot of people feel like they experience the Holy Spirit like it's a spirit and a friend or whatever. It's because a lot of spirits in the spirit world think that's a great way to connect with people. Tell them you're the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Bang.
Okay.
People just allow it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. You say that God connects directly to our soul.
Yep.
But from our point of view, do we always experience it through the body or soul to soul?
Every time we have a connection with God, we will experience it emotionally and generally through both bodies. So you will actually feel the sensation of the connection in both your spirit body and your material body. And if you don't have a material body or a physical body, it'll be just through your spirit body that you will feel the connection. What actually happens physically, if you can see the spirit body, is it brightens up like a sun almost. Like, you know, it goes all of a sudden bright for the period of time you're receiving the love, and then it goes a bit dimmer again. Does that make sense? It's like a light bulb being switched on and off. Now, when we begin initially, it's a very, very overwhelming emotional experience. So usually there's a lot of emotions, usually a lot of grief and other things associated with the reception of the love. As you reach the point of atonement, you get to a point where you're no longer overwhelmed with grief every time you receive the love, but you're overwhelmed with joy, which causes you to still cry, right? So every celestial spirit who still receives divine love, all of them receive divine love, they are in a state when they really focus on it, and when I say focus on it, they, with your connection with God, for your desire to be really pure, it's a connection that you have in a moment that is like every other connection, almost dims in comparison. Does that make sense? Almost feels almost like it's not there, and it's just between you and God. It just feels like you and God, and that's all it feels like in that moment. And God's actually created it that way because it is a unique experience. Now, as you progress with your soul, the two halves of the soul eventually start to join with each other, right? Now, once they two halves of the soul reach the actual joint condition, then they both receive, and if we say red is the blocking, so this is above, they are now both receiving divine love at the same intensity. So it's like, if you could liken it physically, it's like myself and Mary being like that at the same time as we're receiving divine love in a complete connection between ourselves and God as one person. Does that make sense to everyone? It's very hard to describe, but that's what it feels like when you're in a union state. Up until that point in time, you're receiving the divine love in a separate condition, and it's bringing you together. Yeah. But once you get into the union state, that state is a very unique state because you're both receiving divine love at the same intensity, at the same time. And both of you together, in the union state, you don't feel like a separate person anyway. And in the union state, you're receiving divine love. It's like the one, we are one, connecting with God. Does that make sense to everyone? Yeah? Whereas in the at-one-ment with God condition, which is what I described in the first century by saying you have to become born again to become at one with God. In that condition, you are not at one with your soulmate yet. So the other half of your soul might be a separate. The other half of your soul might be in the hills even. And you can still receive divine love to the point of at one with God. You had a question?
I had an experience. I was meditating a lot, and I think I emailed Mary on this, and it was kind of different. So there was a lot of energy coming from the front of the head, and then it felt like there started being levitation and stuff like that in my arms, and then something in a higher place, you know, as I was praying, just there was another little red flag. So I put it down for a little while, and then I just started praying, stopped meditating, started praying, and then like a month later, there was a different type of feeling, but it came from the back of the head.
Yes. Both back and front of head connections are generally with spirits.
Okay.
Both front, back and front. The crown chakra is the primary way that we feel divine love entered, but unfortunately, many spirits masquerade as God based on whether we desire them to do so or not. And so we often give up in our connection with God, and in the process of giving up our connection with God, we now attract spirits who try to masquerade or try to help us, or they feel they're trying to help us, to reconnect, but they believe themselves to be God. So now we're in a different connection altogether. And we'll talk about that in a minute if you wish. But I want to focus firstly on what the actual connection is. So do you understand the role of the Holy Spirit? It's a conduit, a pipe, that connects between God and yourself every time you have this sincere desire, longing for God's love. And when it connects, bang, you are now receiving divine love in the moment. And as soon as you get out of harmony with how much love you've received, it disconnects. So do you understand what I mean by that? As soon as you get out of harmony with how much love you've received, there is a disconnection between the soul and the Holy Spirit.
How do you get out of harmony?
All right, so let's say right at the start we're in a sinful condition or out of harmony with love condition most of the time, and then we realise we can have a longing for God. So the very first time we sit down, and initially we might be a bit like hit and miss with it in terms of like we often think we should just be able to go, oh, I want some God, where are you? And we're a bit sort of what you would say insincere. Right?
It's not like a longing.
Yeah, it's not like a real longing. But after a while what happens is after you generate your desire, you start to feel that I do have a really strong desire, and there might even be some really strong, you feel, and a lot of times this is what happens, people feel a strong desire for connection with God when they feel quite sad about something in their life or whatever like that. Or they feel very joyous about something in their life, and they have this moment in time where they feel all of a sudden in harmony with God and the desire to receive more of that. Now in that moment, the love pours in. Most of the time, most people in the first moment they do it, cry and become afraid very rapidly in succession. Right? It's such an overwhelming experience that for the majority of people, they are instantly triggered into their grief as soon as they receive the love. Because we have so much unworthiness in us as a human race, we start receiving the love and we're instantly triggered into grief. And most of us don't like feeling grief. And so we stop feeling the grief. As soon as you stop feeling the grief, you're out of harmony receiving more love. Bang, the disconnection occurs. The Holy Spirit immediately disconnects. Does that make sense to everyone? And then if we allow the grief to flow, then the reconnection can occur if we have a desire. Yeah?
I was actually going to say what happens if you continue, so you just answered it.
Yep, good.
So I'm not clear when you said in the first century to be born again, that is the same as truly desiring God's love, being in harmony?
No. To be born again means to actually receive so much divine love in your soul through this process that your soul gets into harmony with God and this connection is permanent.
Okay.
As soon as the connection is permanent, your whole soul has gone through a process of complete transformation. this process of complete transformation is like being born again. You have, in fact, all new abilities that you never had before. Mm-hmm. So in the first century beforehand, I couldn't do things like healing, or I wasn't very telepathically connected to other people. I couldn't read their thoughts and all of those kind of things. But as soon as you enter that connection, all of a sudden the soul gets all of these new abilities it never had before, right? And it takes you time, of course, to become aware of some of them, and it takes you time to even accept some of them. But once you're in that permanent connection, now you are in this beautiful place where the soul has been completely transformed into a new creature. It exceeds its original capacity as a human now, because you've now become connected with God completely. So you've gone from the human to the divine, in the sense that you've gone from this feeling inside of you, before was the way we're normally created is just, we can only progress to a certain condition by our own desires, but the rest of our progression needs to involve God. And when the rest of our process involves God, we receive enough love to have a permanent connection with God. By the time we get the permanent connection with God, we have been transformed, completely transformed. And also, we have completely new abilities we never had before. And these abilities are not abilities that spirits give to us, but we have them ourselves. Does that make sense? Nobody has to give them to you. God, through this process, has transformed your soul into having these abilities. When you're in that state, now you're in the at-one-ment state. So you're now in the eighth sphere condition in the spirit world, even if you're on earth, and you now could say to be permanently connected to the Holy Spirit. So there is a glow about you when you go into that state, and that's why a lot of the drawings or paintings of me in the first century all have this halo type thing around and things like that, because people often can see that. Does it make sense?
When we reach at-one-ment, that's the point, isn't it, where we no longer ever feel a separation from God.
Ever. We no longer feel any fear, ever.
And it's when we've lost the sin of self-reliance. It's gone from us.
Yeah,
until that point, we're juggling between God-reliance and self-reliance, but the minute we reach at-one-ment, that's it, we're God-reliant.
It sounds to me, the way you're describing it, that the divine love coming through the Holy Spirit is like an all or nothing thing. It's like, it sounds like if you try to meter it at all, that you're actually going to cut it off.
Exactly. If you try to observe it or meter it while it's happening, you get out of the feeling that you need to maintain the connection.
Okay. So if I think of God, I get this just beautiful loving feeling. But if I'm in a room like this and I feel like I want to stop it because I don't want to cry, then I must be cutting it off. But what is that feeling?
Well, see,
that's not the whole thing. It's just, or is it just my love for God going out?
There is your love for God going out to God, which is a part of the desire that you have. Does that make sense? And then when you allow yourself to fully feel that desire, then usually you'll start receiving love, but you'll also instantly go into some kind of emotional reaction as well. Yeah. And the reason why we go into emotion, and we can't fake it, we can't manufacture the emotional reaction. It's just an automatic reaction when we're in that pure connection with God. So we can't make it happen in an unnatural way either. It has to happen in a purely based on pure, sincere desire. Now, what I was saying before is, when we receive the love, our soul is automatically elevated in its condition of love, automatically in that moment. Now, due to its elevation in the condition of love, there are certain errors in our soul that now become very dominant. And those errors in our soul usually cause us to disconnect from the flow of our love, and now we have to face those errors. When we face those errors and remove them, now when we have a longing for God's love, we can rise to a higher condition. And then usually other deeper errors within our soul are confronted that causes us to disconnect, and then we have to face those errors. And that continues to happen until you reach the seventh dimension, and during the seventh dimensional change, you start even not having your intellect very much involved anymore in any conversation or discussion with any person, and you start transforming quite a lot. But there are a lot of changes to make in the seventh dimension, a lot of physical changes, soul-based changes, which affect both your physical body and your spirit body. And then as you go through those changes, you're receiving divine love, bits and pieces, and usually it's right near the end that the hardest transition is, because right near the end is where you've really got to give up all form of self-reliance. And for the majority of people, that might take some time. So I've known people who have stayed in the seventh dimension for 100 years or longer, while they've waited to give up that process. It's a desire process, so based on desire. But once they make the transition, they're in the eighth dimension, and as soon as they're there, the Holy Spirit now has a permanent connection to a person. And this person, you could say, is now Christed. That person becomes Christ, an expression of God's love wherever they exist, whether it's on earth or in the spirit world. Does that make sense to everyone? And that's the transformation that I'm trying to describe to people using words, which is very hard to do. And that's very, very different from being overcloaked by spirits. Very different process. Which we can describe separately. But I wanted to go on to your second question.
I just had one follow-up question.
Yes?
So how often do, like, how often do you feel this love coming to you? Is it like, all the time? Is it once a year?
I'm in this transformational process, like you are.
Yeah.
And I said to one of the previous groups that I hadn't received divine love for over one year, up until about 3 days ago. I was in Sweden, wasn't I? Up until that point in time, I hadn't received divine love for about a year. Because I was blocked of working through certain things. And I had an evening in Sweden where, just before our last talk actually in Sweden, where I reconnected with some of those things that I've been blocking, and straight away the flow of love starts again. Does that make sense? Anytime you block stuff emotionally, you might go for many years actually without receiving divine love. It doesn't mean you have none in you, because you've already received that much that's transformed your soul, but you don't have a permanent connection, and it's blocked because of what you're choosing to do, not what God's choosing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? God wants us to have a permanent connection, but we're the ones blocking it and pushing the permanent connection away.
And it's true, isn't it, that the divine love we've received up to that point is affecting our nature, and if we act in disharmony with the divine love we've already received, the pain is going to be even more intense than just the normal law of compensation that you would feel.
Yeah.
So you never lose the benefits of having received it, but God, and I find it such a beautiful system that you just described, that we receive some and then the errors appear, and then it's God's way of, like, lovingly as a parent showing us what's blocking us from bliss, really. And that's a beautiful thing, I feel. And so that it's never going to flow while we're holding on to those errors. Yeah.
The problem we have on earth is that we have an external environment that's very against us having the connection with God in this manner. And for that reason, we at times fall into patterns of behaviour that were old patterns of behaviour, not because of wanting to do it ourselves, but because we feel pushed into it through fear from our environment. When we're in those places, unfortunately on earth, we can degrade a bit in our condition, but because we've received love to a certain degree, when we degrade in condition, the pain of degrading is actually worse. And we want to get back up to the previous state. Does that make sense? So that there is actually a prevention inside of this system that causes us to not want to degrade too far. Because if we degrade too far, there is huge amounts of pain. And many of the 14 who returned to Earth are in huge amounts of pain because of the difference between those two states. The other thing to bear in mind with the connection is that it is such a strong and overwhelming connection that you're not able to feel other connections while you're having this connection until you've had the permanent connection and you're used to that. Does that make sense? And when you get sort of used to it is the best way. You get used to being in this permanent connection with God. You now find your interactions with other people relatively, well, all very easy, actually, whether the other person's in the hells or and very angry and rageful, or another person who's in a bright condition, you can interact with them very easily, every single time. It doesn't mean that they'll feel the interaction is pleasant, because the truth you're in also usually confronts the person quite strongly. Yeah. Yep.
Okay, let's see. What is the difference in feeling between a spirit guide and the Holy Spirit?
Right. Can you see that the Holy Spirit is not an actual spirit, for a start? It's not a person. Whereas when we talk about spirits, we're talking about people. So let's put our person up here. Now, a person is, in the spirit world, is a half of a soul connected with a single body, a spirit body. So they still have their soul. That's the spirit. So that person there is the spirit. Let's call them a spirit person to differentiate.
Who is a guide in this case?
Well, it could be a guide, or it could be a person who's malevolent. It could be a person who's benevolent. It could be a person with any form of injuries. It could be a person who's at one with God themselves. It could be any person in between that range. This spirit. It just depends on their condition. Now, they have the means to give us love as well. Now, you can imagine that if my condition of love here, this soul here, is in a first sphere condition of love, which usually when we begin this process we are, then any person who's in a greater condition of love is going to feel very loving. Right? And unfortunately, for many people on earth, many of these spirits who are in a more loving condition believe themselves to be God. Because they have the New Age philosophy that we're not separate entity to God. They have a New Age philosophy that we are all fragmentations of God. Right? And because they have this philosophy, they believe themselves to be God. And so when they give you their love, there's often a voice associated with this love. There's often words associated with the love. And they're telling you, I'm God loving you now, or they're telling you something, right, audibly sometimes, or as a sound, an audible sound. And that's a spirit person who's in a better condition of love than you are, but giving you their love. But because they believe they're God, they think they're giving you God's love. Does that make sense? So that they don't know that this exists. They believe that what they're giving you is God's love. This is what's happening for many people on earth who believe they're receiving God's love. They're actually receiving love from a spirit, and sometimes it's not even love from a spirit, it's addictions from a spirit. The darker the spirit, the more the spirit will be in addictions. And a lot of times we believe our addictions to be love. This is a problem we face on earth when we're in addiction. When somebody satisfies our addiction, we go, oh, they love us. Right? And if they don't satisfy our addiction, we go, oh, they're a terrible person. You know? And so we feel the same with different spirits. If the spirit is above a first sphere condition, in other words, the spirit's in a second sphere or higher condition, he could either be, or she could either be on the divine love path, in other words, that she could be connecting to God directly, or she could be on the natural love path where she's developing herself, but she will definitely feel a lot better in love than you. And so whenever she gives you love, there might be the misinterpretation inside of you that it's God's love, but it's actually the love from a person who's in a greater state of love than yourself.
Because
yeah?
Often it can be our actual spirit guide, can't it?
Mm.
Loving
yeah.
us because they do love us.
Yeah. And many of your spirit guides are in very good condition, some of them celestial sphere condition. So when they give you their love, it's going to feel very overwhelming, and you're probably going to be just as overwhelmed with it sometimes as God's love entering you, right? But they can give you their love under different conditions.
Can the connection with God through the Holy Spirit have the ability to heal you, your material body or your physical body?
Not can. definitely does.
Okay.
When you connect with God to the point of abandonment, every single thing within your physical body will be healed, and on top of that, you will grow young again. You will actually, every spirit who connects to God and becomes at one with God looks around 20 to 25 years of age. Every single one. When you do this on earth, you will look around 20 to 25 years of age. It will just take a little bit longer for your physical body to respond. So our physical body has a cell replication process that happens around every 7 years. So by 7 years, if you become at one with God, by 7 years later, everything in your body would automatically be healed, and your age would go, you'd look like 25 years old. Does that make sense?
Hopefully a better version than I looked when I was 25.
Well, Mary spent a bit of time drinking when she was 25.
And eating.
She quite often woke up looking terrible. I thought I looked pretty good when I was 25.
So I have a question about the Holy Spirit. Is
yep.
it always just transmitting God's love?
That's it.
And is that, are we receiving things like wisdom from God before we reach atonement, like different substances, or does that come as a result of the love we receive?
Yeah, we do not, at the moment it is not, there are no other substances that we receive directly from God. That doesn't mean that in the future that will be it will be discovered the way to receive other substances from God. But love at the moment is the only substance that we've discovered that we can receive from God. But when the love enters this soul has automatically expanded in its capacity to understand everything. Right? So now when it examines truth or examines things physically, scientifically, physical things on the earth, spirit body things in the spirit world, anything to do with the universe, it has a far larger capacity, due to being soul-centric now, has a far larger capacity to understand everything in the universe automatically. Not given to you by spirits again. So this is not information given to you by other people, but it's information you discover through your own process. The soul has the ability to absorb that information at far more rapid paces than anybody on earth has ever experienced besides myself at this point, which I only experienced in the first century.
I hope this question isn't off the topic too much, but I've been in the presence of several spiritual luminaries, you could call them, where they emit a very tangible, what they call transmission, for example, that seems to bliss out and center everybody in their presence.
Yep.
I'm just wondering.
Why doesn't that happen around us?
That wasn't my question. I'm just wondering what the dynamics of that are.
What's happening is the person is almost completely overcloaked by a fairly well-developed spirit on the natural love path. And that spirit is using the connection to feed the addictions of every single person in their presence. So every single person in their presence automatically feels good as a result. It doesn't mean that they are giving them love. They are feeding the addictions of every single person present. Right?
Or helping them, like someone said, really smooth over the emotions.
Yep.
And sometimes there's whole groups of spirits associated with one spirit.
Sometimes thousands of people.
Teacher, who whenever someone comes in the vicinity of them, they go, oh, this is our way to help them, heal them, make them feel good, or feed the addiction of the guy that I, this spiritual teacher. So we can give them energy, give them emotions.
And that's why they call it a transmission. Right? It's not actually love, it's a transmission of a certain type of energy for each person, depending on the person's emotional injury. And every single person in an audience will feel it as bliss. But unfortunately, it's just feeding many of their addictions. And because of the power of a group of spirits who are in a higher condition, they can easily do that and make everybody in a room feel quite good. Right? Now those kind of spirits are not on the divine love path. Right? They are all on the natural love path, and they are trying to have the impact of having people on earth believe they are God. So the whole belief, I am God, comes from these spirits who are separate from God, because they believe they are God. And unfortunately, this belief that we are God, a fragment of God, is actually a major impediment to receiving divine love.
And if you think about it, could never be spirits on the divine love path, because they're at one with God. And we know that God wants us to confront our errors so we can have a personal relationship with them. So if there's a spirit giving us help to smooth over everything, jump over everything and be instantly blissed out, then we know that they're going against what God wants for us, which is to heal ourselves.
So. Yeah. And this is why in the first century, not everyone around me was blissed out. Does that make sense? Right? Because the Pharisees, for example, were very confronted. Many of my own so-called followers were very confronted. Like, they would often, I'd be walking along, and they wouldn't be with me walking along. They'd be a few hundred metres back walking along, complaining about what I just said. Right? Many of them were like that. And they'd be complaining, and some of them, like with John and James, I call them sons of thunder because they complained a lot, right? They were quite verbal about the complaint. And Peter was often the ringleader of complaint, right? So the women were often far better. Some of the women would walk with us generally. Because, see, every time I walked with Mary in the first century, every one of the men didn't want to walk with us. Because to them that was like, they viewed me as demeaning them. Right? By honouring a woman as my equal, they viewed me, all of my followers at the time, viewed me as demeaning them. Right? And so they would often, if I walked with Mary, they'd be walking way back there somewhere complaining about how I'm walking with Mary.
Which, if you think about it, is confronting their error, isn't it? It's confronting their issue in life.
So not everybody with me in the first century felt blissed out. In fact, most people felt not blissed out at all, but rather very confronted. A spirit who is in an appointment condition with God is often very confronting because they'll state truth. There'll be love coming out of them, but they'll also be stating truth that is often very confronting for us emotionally. Yeah?
I feel that from you.
Yeah? The confrontation.
And a lot of people feel that, you know. So, and that's what gets some people angry, you know. And when I say some, most people. And that is the result of the confrontation between truth and error inside of a person's soul. And a spirit who's connected at one with God is okay with that confrontation. In fact, they feel it's necessary.
It's loving.
And loving because it's necessary for the person to see their error. A spirit in this condition feeds the addictions because they don't want you to... They're imitating God. They're trying to imitate God by giving you all of these blissed emotions without you having to deal with any of your own addictions, without you having to deal with any of your own errors. And this is why these spirits on earth often feel like God to everybody. They go, oh, I'm in that presence of that person, and it's so wonderful. And yet they do also describe funny things, like some of them, like you've heard of Say Barbara and ones like this, yeah? Some people, some of our friends spend a lot of time with them, and they said, there were times when you felt just like totally unconditional love from the person, and then the next moment you hear of them doing something sexual or something like that, which is very opposite to what love would do. So there'd be this duality that would occur with many of these individuals. The reason why is because the spirit can't maintain the connection permanently with the person they are overcloaking on earth. And so the person's true nature and condition starts coming out under certain circumstances. And then, of course, the spirit overcloaks them again when they've got the energy to do so, and then they change again. And you often see in spirituality, so-called New Age spirituality, a shift between what I would call instant shifts or instant changes in people. And instant changes in people are never real. They're always to do with some facade going on between themselves and a spirit. Because receiving God's love doesn't result in instant change. You have to actually have a desire to change, and you have to see what the love confronts in you to change. And it has to be a real change inside of your soul. Thanks, Carol, for doing all this.
You mentioned the spirit guides and how they're at different levels, and I was wondering then, does that mean that your spirit guide doesn't stay the same throughout your whole process of growing at one with God, then
it may change.
It may change.
And is there a process of how you would get a specific spirit guide, or do they just decide, or are they just drawn to a specific person? Or
I've just answered all of those questions to a group in England in a presentation. So
the whole presentation was really about spirit guides.
Guides and guardians, So they had lots of questions like that. So rather than answering them now,
I'd rather have a listen to that.
Can we read the next question, though, that you had as a part of this question?
There was three or four.
Oh, okay. Well, the second one I didn't read, but it says, does it come only when we receive, does the Holy Spirit come only when we receive divine love? And then is it within us to guide us through feelings?
Yeah. So does the Holy Spirit only come to us when we receive divine love? It's the other way around. Divine love can only come to us once the connection with the Holy Spirit is made. So we receive divine love through the connection with the Holy Spirit. So the connection with the Holy Spirit has to happen first before the divine love can flow. And the connection with the divine love happens through this, and I often in the first century called it the spirit or the energy of truth. So we need to be in a place of emotional truth, not intellectual truth, but emotional truth for divine love to flow.
For us to connect to the Holy Spirit.
Which when we have the longing then, the divine love will flow.
For emotional truth, I had a memory that came after listening to you speak about holding something in your hand when you were a child, and that connection to God. Mm-hmm. And it stirred a memory I had not had before of being 6 years old, sneaking off the playground, going into the church by myself, because I always loved the feeling in it, mm-hmm. and sitting across from the statue of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Mm-hmm. Now, I never took what the sister said about Mary and Jesus and all being alone. I thought we were all the same. You know, I always felt that little baby was like my brother and that woman was like my mother. And I always felt the manipulation of those teachings.
Yeah.
But what I felt was the tears and the pain of not being held like she was holding her child, that I had not had that with my mother.
So the pain of not being loved
by... The pain of not being embraced by my mother, you know? And seven kids and all of us. But what happened in that moment, all the tears that came, and all of a sudden I felt held.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I felt held. And this feeling that came over, the memory now was so big. And I can't remember, I don't know how I never remembered that. You know, it left.
Yeah.
Like at seven, I reached the conditioning of humankind, you know, and all the innocence and everything left.
Yeah.
And so this came back after listening to you.
Yeah.
And now every time I even speak of the words longing for God's love, it just always.
Yeah,
so my question was, at that moment at six, was that reception of divine love?
There were two things happening for you at six. My mother, Mary, I'm talking about now, not my girl Mary, but my mother Mary, and Joseph and Mary, and often feels deep love for any person who connects with her. So she will often come, and when a person's looking for comfort or longing, and there's quite a lot of people, particularly in the Catholic religion, who frequently look for that, my mother often comes and gives them a hug or gives them the feeling of being held or hugged so that they connect to that pain that they have. And many people, when they connect to that pain they have of not being held by their own mothers, but they reflect about longing for that from God, in that moment that my mum's hugging them, often also receiving divine love. Does that make sense? And those two things happen at the same time, pretty much. So
in the innocence, as a six-year-old,
yeah,
the reception of divine love begins that reception of divine love in your life. And
yes.
So then
there
can be little experiences along the way.
Yes, that's
that
right.
Keep adding to the container.
Most of you have had little experiences along your life where you have received some divine love, right? Without really understanding the experiences or understanding how to replicate the experience. And this is a common thing on the planet.
Many people who have, there's some people who have spiritual awakenings that just get overcloaked, but many people who go through a really big time of hardship in their life often suddenly find they're overwhelmed by emotion, and suddenly they're open to God and they receive divine love, and then they spend the rest of their life trying to figure out how that happened.
The rest of my life crying.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody would say to me, "You're always crying. You're always." Somebody would name me Big Heart with Flowing Tears, you know? I mean, it just, the tears would just come. I'd see an AT&T commercial and the tears would come. And all the movies that you recommended, I've seen them all, and I've cried and laughed and cried with all
of them. Can I point out, though, Carol, that if the tears continue to flow, you're not getting to the bottom of what the underlying causal grief is that's being triggered.
Right.
And this is something that we also need to bear in mind, that if tears continue to flow for long periods of time, we need to understand we're not getting to the bottom of them.
Right.
And we'd be far better off looking at, am I addicted to these tears flowing now in some way? Is this addiction preventing me from finding the real grief that's within me?
And in each case, and it's, with other guidance I've had, as well as since connecting the last 8 months, I have gone to the deeper place, you know?
Yeah.
But the one thing that always still gets me now is just because I hadn't reconnected to the truth that God is a personal being.
Yeah.
I had left the Catholic Church like most and gone to the place that God is everything, but that never felt quite right either.
No.
So when connecting with you, that has triggered a new, you know,
desire for the entity,
exactly,
God, the creator. Yeah.
And so that also is what brought the memory of that embrace.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing is that first it was an embrace that felt like a mother's embrace, but then it was a stronger embrace, and it felt like a father's embrace.
Yeah.
And so I had this sense of it all being the same.
Can I put to you, though, that you have dealt with a fair degree of mum-based emotions, but there is still a lot of dad-based emotions.
Yeah, he left when I was 18 and I helped raise the family.
Yeah, but there is a lot of grief about your relationship with dad yet to feel. And that prevents you from feeling the masculine side of God as well. So, does that make sense? So the key is to allow yourself to work your way through that. And I suggest to you, actually, the reason why you haven't up to this stage is because you're often crying about the mum side of this, but neglecting the dad because of the rage that's within you about the dad side. And there is rage within you about it. So you're first going to have to connect to the rage about the dad side, and then the fear, and then the grief. It's going to be harder for you to do that.
I can feel it. Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. Thank you.
No worries. Is that the end of that
question? I think so, yeah.
So the reason why I wanted to, is it Carol, isn't it?
Caroline.
To ask those questions is because that is a very basic part of the teachings of divine truth. In fact, it's a core part of the teachings of divine truth. And if we always remember it, we'll remember some basic principles of it. Firstly, if I'm not receiving divine love, what can be the only cause? Me. Something in me. And there has to be something wrong with either one of two things. Either I don't have a sincere longing for it to enter me, or number two is that I'm not in harmony with truth that I need to be in harmony with. Emotional truth. They're the only two reasons why I wouldn't be in connection with it. So if you're not receiving it permanently, and all of us here are not receiving it permanently, we need to examine why, if we wish to ever become at one with God. Now, a spirit who has become Christed has actually examined themselves so much that they've removed from themselves all impediments for this love to flow permanently. And their love and the Holy Spirit now connects permanently with them and flows permanently into them whenever they long for it, because there is no impediment to the connection. The impediment to the connection of Holy Spirit is truth. The impediment to the flow of divine love, once truth is connected, is longing. Do you see the relationship between those two things? So this is where the basic principles of divine truth get back to three basic things. Humility, which is the passionate desire to feel and experience all of our own emotions and the passionate desire to be able to change our beliefs, no matter what they are, to conform to God's beliefs, opens the door, so it's like a doorway, into us receiving truth. Now, once we receive truth, we have the ability to connect to the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. It is the Spirit that allows the connection between ourselves and God. And so it's like a conduit that can only connect to us when we're in the moment of truth, in a moment. And truth is the doorway to receiving divine love. They are the three basic principles. So simple to understand, not easy to do, but simpler to understand. Right? A child can understand this, and that's why a child can connect to God, which is what you would expect, surely. So that's the beauty of it, and that's why I wanted to... It was a good question, and I thought, there's quite a few hundred questions
can
in there.
I don't
know if there's 100, but it's quite a few. We're going to answer a lot of them, but in an interview process at some point. Yeah.
I'm just getting nuts to tell you that there are a lot of people here who aren't permanently connected to God.
In spirit form.
Yeah, they wanted me to. Yeah. Hey, don't forget about us.
Yeah. So I'm talking to those in the physical.
Yes. No, I just got nuts to tell you that there are many hundreds of people here who are permanently connected to God. We just can't see them.
They're all in spirit.
Our spirit friends.
Yeah. Hi. You want to say hi to them? One of the things I love doing is acknowledging our spirit friends who have been present in an interaction, because there are literally usually thousands and sometimes millions of them present. And many of our celestial friends that myself and Mary know personally are often present, in these meetings as well, trying to help each one of you have your realizations. You know how sometimes when I speak, you go, So that's often your spirit guides and spirit friends helping you have these realizations when
and
something's
they said. They love for us to acknowledge it, because immediately, and I don't know if you felt it, immediately you become more open to them and aware of them, and that we acknowledge them. So that's why they nudged me.
behind them, yes.
I just have a quick question.
It's okay.
Guardian angel is another word for spirit guide or spirit?
No. I've explained that
in the other talk.
In that other talk, yep. Two separate, they can be the same person, but they're two separate roles.
Okay.
And we talk about
spirit guide and guardian.
Okay.
Enrique?
I was wanting to ask about earth changes in the U.S. and what you feel about that now. And also something I've asked you about before, location of a possible learning center.
Yep.
We've talked about Arizona before.
Yep.
And if you could please provide latitude and longitude, I'd appreciate it.
Specific date,
time. You don't want much, do you?
Possible.
Are we talking North America or the USA? What are we talking?
I guess USA.
Right. North America. For others, it's going to be Canada, North America. Let's be specific about the USA. My feelings at present, and please understand that my feelings at present, I am not at one with God, as you know, because you'd feel if I was. So my feelings at present are based on my current set of emotions and so forth. However, I've probably dealt with quite a lot, and definitely have dealt with quite a lot about different things. So I have a degree of certainty about these things. But I can't be 100% certain about anything that I'm now saying to you. So you need to bear that in mind, and therefore you need to trust your own guidance from your spirit friends who are guiding you to influence you in different decisions you make. However, that being said, my strong feelings at this point in time is that the USA is going to be very severely affected by coming events. And when I say very severely affected, your landmass will be probably divided in two through the events. And many areas of the U.S., the continental U.S., will be inundated by large amounts of water, and a lot of the parts of the U.S. will completely sink under the sea, down to a depth perhaps even of a few thousand meters. Right? Now, if I can describe where I see all those things happening. For a start, where the Mississippi is, the Mississippi up to the Great Lakes and into Canada, that entire area will be completely separate from each other with a large mass of sea in between those two areas. Right? Most of the low-lying areas that are under 100 metres will be inundated at some point, and permanently so. So a lot of the low-lying areas down near Florida and so forth, there are some exceptions, and we'll talk about, I feel, will be underwater, particularly southern Florida, definitely underwater. And there are parts of Florida, there will be a landmass rising out of the Atlantic through these different compression events that occur, and that landmass will have its compression effect on Florida, so parts of the Florida landmass and the East Coast may actually finish up rising in terms of rising out of the sea. But unfortunately, you've got to ask the question of how livable a lot of those events are going to be during the change. On the West Coast, well, obviously most of you know more about the West Coast in terms of its seismic activity and so forth. So you're talking all the down the Rockies, on the western side of the Rockies. You've basically got faults and folds all the way through that area, right up through Vancouver, right up into Alaska. And all of that region is going to be severely impacted, and a lot of it will probably crack away and sink completely into the sea. There'll be large areas of landmass affected by that event. That's my feelings at this point in time. There will also be the supervolcano. There are three supervolcanoes that you have that are potentially able to go off in the USA, in continental USA. They all go up. They are all on the eastern side of the Rockies, most of them. And of course, the one that you well know is Yellowstone National Park. But there are two others further south as well, along the same, almost if you draw a line straight down the map, 1,000 kilometres away from each other, three super volcanoes. Historically, they've gone off once every 600, usually 1,000 years. And the last time yours went off, the ash-covered areas that were nearly 1,200 kilometres away, down to a depth of 12 feet deep. They actually have seismic records of these events. So if one of those supervolcanoes go off, it's definitely not going to be very pleasant in any region in midwestern USA and on the coast of the West. And potentially the ash from it will cover a lot of the United States due to the rotation of the Earth. And the ash will cover a lot of the United States. So bearing all that in mind, the question then becomes, well, where's safe? Or where's relatively safe? Well, firstly, we need to look at a few things as the question of safety. Can I do that?
As to the question of safety?
It's very important to understand safety from God's perspective. The safest person to ever be with is God. You develop that relationship, your safety is automatically enhanced. Do you understand?
Exponentially
enhanced. Second thing, your safety is automatically enhanced when you live in a state of truth, humility, and desire. In other words, you don't wait for somebody else to come along and fix up your life. You choose to actually engage your life more fully, your passions and your desires more fully. What are your passions and desires? Engage them more fully. While you're engaging your passions and desires, there's this beautiful thing that kicks into place. God, through the help of your guide and guardian spirits, can guide you once you engage your passions and desires. If you sit at home watching telly without engaging your passions and desires, it's very hard for a spirit to guide you, because the first thing they've got to do is kick you off the couch before they can even guide you, right? So this is very, very important to engage your desires and passions, right? Now, the fifth issue is about self-responsibility.
And can I just add, I think it relates to this point especially. Do you remember that your spirit guides gave us some information that AJ spoke about when we began yesterday, which was all about common injuries that affect people living in the United States? And if you guys were to seriously engage those injuries in terms of wanting to heal them, you'd almost become, like, many people would change into entirely different people. You know, you'd be much more connected to your true desires and passions.
And many of you that are spread all over the country, USA, would feel a pull to each other. Like, you'd feel a draw to spend more time and feel a draw to creating some kind of center where other people can learn about divine truth as well. Does that make sense? Many of you would automatically feel that.
It's sort of like putting the horse before the cart to go, right, this is the latitude and longitude, this is a place you should do it all, when everyone's still neglecting these things, you know. When those things are engaged, the synergy would be amazing, especially if lots of you did it. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'll describe some of that in practice as to what's happened to some people, including myself and Mary, in our life with engaging these things properly. But let's look at this area of self-responsibility. Remember yesterday I mentioned it in a number of different areas. Do you remember what those areas were?
Water.
Food.
Shelter.
And then?
Power. No.
Comfort. How comfortable do you want to be? Being responsible for your own comfort. Now, for the average person in the USA, if events occur such as what I'm describing, there'll be no pumped water, there'll be no, you know, trucked food supply, there'll be no electricity, probably, in most places, no power production. And in fact, there may actually be many of your nuclear reactors have a big struggle as well as a result of all of these things. So there is potentially going to be a very harsh environment very rapidly. If you're not already prepared, automatically there's going to be a degree of discomfort. That makes sense, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Now, ironically, these things are the exact same things you need to be prepared for no matter what happens.
Right.
Whether there's an economic failure, whether there's anything that happens here, these are still the same things you'd be concerned about. And in fact, if you think about it, logically, whether any event occurs or not, these are still important concerns. They are the basic necessities of life, which we need to start addressing. So, the idea then, the only question then we have is, okay, if we're going to engage all of those things, the sixth, and in my feeling least important, is where? Do you understand? Now, it is important, because if you would like to be a part of what the new world is going to look like, and it's going to be a pretty fantastic period of time, I believe, and if these changes occur as they currently seem to be going to occur, then it's going to be a pretty amazing period of time where people will have to go back to the basics of life, and that's going to cause a lot of emotions to go through. People are going to need to work their way through their different issues and so forth. So where then? Now, where is very dependent on this other negative factor, and that is this thing. Yep. We often ask the question where because we are already afraid. Right? Now, fear has its own creation. fear automatically draws to it things that we actually are trying to avoid. Mm-hmm. What we're afraid of, we finish up pulling into our life. And it's not what we think we're afraid of, because many of us don't think we're afraid of anything. It's what, as a feeling, we are afraid of. Yeah? And that's what pulls us in. So besides these things, fear is a primary emotion we need to address. Right? Now, when I talk about where, and when I say all the things I've just said, most people get very afraid, which means they are no longer dealing with their fear. They just, what do I do? What do I do? Where do I go? Where do I go? They're not feeling their fear and releasing it. You need to feel your fear and release it before you're going to have clarity about where. Now, because I have no fear about the United States or any other place on the planet, I can say with a fair degree of accuracy, I feel, where are going to be the safer places to live in your country. But the reality is, you could do the same thing if you get rid of your fear about what's going to happen in the United States. Right? Everybody can do the same thing on Earth. Now, in direct answer to your direct question, bearing in mind my caveats at the beginning of this conversation, the places that are going to be relatively safe, you've got Texas here with the Gulf, that's Texas. Right up the top of Texas, where we currently are, is going to be a relatively safe location. Right? However, you have nuclear reactors, yeah, all down here. You have the Gulf water, which will flow over a lot of the land. You also have these supervolcano events, which will dump ash. So when I say it's going to be relatively safe, I'm not saying it's going to be that comfortable. Do you understand? But it is survivable and will not be a permanent situation. So in other words, you don't need to worry that the supervolcano is going to go off for the next 500 years, because the amount of material that a supervolcano puts into the air, with the amount of force it does, it's very rare for them to sustain long periods of eruption. And in fact, usually they only have one eruption. And the people in the spirit world who have studied all of these things historically, because nobody was around when the last one happened on Earth, and the people in the spirit world who have studied them have seen these supervolcanoes go off. There is some people, by the way, in the spirit world who have seen 7 Earth change events occur. Right. You've heard of Michael. You call him the Archangel Michael, but he doesn't like to be called that. And he has seen 7 Earth change events occur on the planet, around once every 16,000 years. And so he has seen many of these volcanoes go off and all of these other things happen. Some of the issues have been more severe than the others. Yeah? So if you allow all of that to come into play, you can see that in the USA itself, there is not going to be too many locations which have a large degree of comfort and survivability at the same time.
Any places in Canada?
Yes, there are places in Canada. So let's talk about Canada. And by the way, can I also make a note? Okay, but Mary does not even feel Earth changes will occur.
Dent. Keep up that thought, Mary.
Yeah, but hey, I acknowledge I've got a lot of emotional issues with it, so that AJ doesn't have. So logic would tell us that he would have more clarity than me.
I'm not very good at drawing the US, sorry about that. So here's Alaska up there, yeah. Here's the USA here, and where is it, about here? And here's Canada, yes?
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is, if you've got the Rockies through here, all of this side of the Rockies, very dangerous location to stay in. And definitely not survivable. Now, I know there's many people who live in these areas who totally disagree with me. Right? And to be frank, a lot of the times when I'm speaking with them, I can feel why they disagree with me. It's because they love that location.
Yeah.
And they're just addicted to the idea it's going to survive, basically. Even though all of the events around them are telling them that it's highly seismic and there's all these other issues. So Vancouver is about here somewhere, isn't it? On the border? Is that right? I've got my geography right.
On the coast.
And Seattle are just underneath, isn't it?
Yep.
Yeah. On this side we've got Boston on the USA and New York.
Philadelphia.
And then we're
doing a roll call of wherever.
And we got North, South Carolina, and then down into Florida, haven't we? Georgia is somewhere in there. And then around the Gulf countries, we've got Texas is obviously one of those, and then the others.
Louisiana,
Mississippi. And you've got the Mississippi coming up here, yes?
Yeah.
To, is it Detroit, the Lake, Michigan?
The Great Lakes.
The Great Lakes. And then we're into Canada. There's Quebec and so forth. About there, I think.
Yeah, Nova Scotia.
And then over here you've got New Brunswick, you guys from New Brunswick's over here. And then you've got, is it Newfoundland or something?
Greenland.
There's an area up around here which should be quite safe in different pockets of locations as well. The super volcano that goes off will be around here. And so it's got a fair way it has to travel before those things happen. But you've also got sea-based events going in both directions, unfortunately, and all down this coast here. Then there is the Tennessee Mountains through here, isn't there? The mountains are...
Appalachians.
What do you call them?
Appalachians.
Appalachians, yeah. And so in amongst here, there is a possibility of safety as well, right? Where you've got, but highly seismic. So, potential high seismic activity, but a degree of safety. So here we are in Dallas. So we're talking very similar, I think, latitude, if I remember rightly, the mountains. You don't really want to be on that side of the mountains, on the eastern side of the mountains, because you've got the Atlantic events then that affect that. So on this side, you've got the Pacific events affecting it, on this side, the Atlantic events. You've got the ash coming from the supervolcano, and the Earth will tilt, and there'll be large waves coming, and unfortunately, some of the waves will be going that direction on one side of your state, on one side of your country, and on the opposite direction on the other side of the country, and so there'll... And there'll also be this wobble that occurs, probably, as a result of the movement of the water over the landmass, which potentially will cause inundation after the major event.
So what about in here? I think that's pretty much affected by...
In here, I would find... Well, it's already very cold a lot of the year, isn't it, in there?
Mm-hmm.
But also, because you've got the funneling of the Arctic air, but also the problem is that you've got lots of ash, and in fact there is a degree of possibility of getting high temperature ash in those locations, which would mean quite severe effects, not survivable.
Any room left in Australia?
there's room left all over the world. There's lots of areas of the world that won't be affected by events, and lots of areas of the world that would be very safe, assuming that we've dealt with our fear. See, because our fear is what attracts people who are unsafe. Now, can I just raise the issue of people who are unsafe? And here in the USA, there is a high number of armaments, guns, and subsequent things, and also a low desire for self-responsibility. Those two combined factors are potentially going to cause more problems than anything else. they will actually begin to cause problems the moment your economy fails. So those problems will start before any earth change events. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And when I say before any earth change events, assuming the earth change events occur in other locations that cause the economy to crash, if the economy hasn't already crashed before then, the economy itself crashing is going to cause a lot of anarchy. And unfortunately, there are a lot of demands, and this is why I addressed this issue of demands for you, there are a lot of demands in the average American person to have their comforts met. And there is also a tendency to resort to violence if those comforts are not met. And so this is a fairly large issue, and it's an issue of fear that most of you need to address as well, fear of anarchy, fear of people being anarchists. And there's some excellent movies that can help you address that fear. Would you like to know? One is called The Road. Have you seen that?
Yeah, most of you have seen that.
That will help you address, at least connect with some of the fears that, of different things. Now that being said, it's going to be very interesting living after changes events occur, once everything's calmed down. Because you'll have a very different topography in terms of the layout of the country. But also, I feel people will start sort of gathering together in communities to display love to each other in order to survive. And this time period on the earth is going to be a very interesting time period. Right? And in different locations, very interesting time period. So my suggestion is, if you want to be a part of the changes that love can bring to the planet, stick around on the planet and make choices that will cause you to stick around on the planet. Yeah.
So this is a question about the flip side of that, because I've been reading that trilogy, Through the Mists. So if this were to happen and millions of people or hundreds of million people
were to pass,
yep. Does that change things in the spirit world? Or
yes.
Is there a need for more workers, for
yes.
example?
Yes.
Here on Earth, actually.
Yeah, more here on Earth than in the spirit world sometimes, uh-huh. because remember, spirits often more easily connect to people on Earth than they do other spirits, particularly if they're in dark condition. And so we badly need people who are mediums to be ready for the changes mm-hmm. to help many of these people make transitions. However, the trauma of transition is going to be different, because many communities will pass over all at once. And because they pass over all at once, you don't experience the grief of separation from your family or your friends, because all of your friends and your family have passed at the same time. Does that make sense? And so a lot of them will pass over, not even really realising that they've actually passed mm-hmm. over, because all their friends and all their family and all of their community has passed over with them. But there is a large amount of work going on at the moment in the spirit world that we've been preparing for nearly 100 years to actually build up what you would call here on Earth institutions, but they're not like that in the spirit world, but to build up things that will allow us to be able to help billions of people make a transition that many of them are not ready for.
Which is actually quite beautiful, isn't it? Really?
Yeah.
And just like everything God does.
So many of our celestial friends at the moment are heavily involved in this preparation mm-hmm. process, as you can imagine, mm-hmm. like getting everything ready so that when people pass, every single person will have some kind of personal assistance, because you're talking billions of people potentially passing. Many of these people will need personal assistance, and normally, under normal circumstances, they would be given personal assistance, every single person. And so what we're trying to do in the spirit world is create this ability. Sorry? How was that?
FEMA camps in spirit.
Camps in spirit. Yeah, they're more pleasant locations generally, but they're reception, places of reception, if you like, that allow people to make the transition between the earth life and the spirit life. Yeah.
In the meantime, there's heaps of spirit guides who are trying to guide anyone who actually does have the desire to stay here.
Mm-hmm.
they're really trying to guide you. But while we all sit in our addictions and our fears, the hands are tied. Mm-hmm.
And while we're addicted to a location, like I find many people we've talked to on the planet are addicted to specific locations. You know, they want to believe their location will survive. Everyone wants to believe where they are will be good. And what we've got to do is have a lot more openness emotionally than that, and allow ourselves to consider, all right, what do I do? If I engage my real passions and desires, where would I be? What would I be doing? Like, for many of you already, some of you I've known for many years, and I've heard from you that you have a passion to, like, assist other people to discover the divine truth and things like that. But the question you've got to ask yourself is, are you doing that? Mm-hmm. And is your life reflecting that desire that you have? Are you making changes in your life to actually make that happen? Yeah?
I wanted to say what was very interesting, because I saw you in Greece, because I used to live there for 3 years, and one of the first things I said when you came here, I was like, oh, I hope they don't talk about earth changes again. But I
What was the effect it had on you?
Okay, it was really intense for me. I left Greece shortly after. I mean, I left for my soulmate, who I feel is here, but it was also at the same time, and considering everything that's going on there, I kind of don't feel bad about leaving.
Yeah.
But since then, I've had 4 dreams about tsunamis hitting me in New York.
Yeah.
One of the last dreams was I saw myself pass, like drown, and then look at my body, and then the feeling was, okay, now I can start living. So what's interesting was that I had to address, this was something that's been throughout my whole life, and the question I asked you earlier about being born, I want to know why I don't want to stay.
Yeah.
And if I'm not real about that, because I also have something inside of me that really feels about assisting others through painting, and I really have, this is increasing more and more from like a really humble place, because I feel like I don't deserve to do that for people, but I have a huge passion for it. And in New York, opportunities are arising, and I'm going to be teaching painting to people, which is really great, children and adults.
Yeah.
And what I want to say is that at this point, I don't know where to be. I know that I'm not making any definitive decisions about buying a place in New York. I know
What do you feel your dreams are indicating?
That I don't want to live.
Yes. So it feels to me you've already made a choice. You've already made a choice to actually pass during earth changes and to live your life in the spirit world.
Okay.
And up until then, you want to follow your passion and desire for painting, and that's fine. But it feels to me you've already made a choice. The question you have to ask yourself is, why have you made such a choice?
I think that's where I want to go with
that. And for many of us, we make such a choice because we actually do believe that life here on earth is hopeless. We actually do believe that life here on earth is pointless. That we want to go somewhere else where we feel it might be nicer. Right?
Yeah, but I know now I'm seeing that that's not the truth. Like, something is shifting. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here.
Exactly.
I feel that. It's almost like I'm demanding it from my soul, but like, it's my God-given right to receive this truth and change.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's like really big for me.
Yeah.
But I have to be honest, because I feel a lot of people feel that way and they don't verbalize.
Yeah. Yeah. And also they don't act upon it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Marina, I have similar feelings, I definitely used to have very similar feelings about, I just want to go to the spirit world. And you know what is really related to me, I think your law of attraction, or what your soul's attracting right now, is perfect, given the discussions that we've had in the past 2 days.
Mm.
It's very much related to this same emotion that I have and I know you have, which is, love can't conquer evil. It's hopeless. I'm going to be hurt. And this feeling that in the spirit world, it would be different.
And there's a feeling in many that it's going to be more evil after changes, because of the anarchy or potential anarchy, no governmental systems working well and so forth. And so many people have already decided, billions of people in fact, have already decided that they're not going to want to live anyway.
Yeah.
They've already decided that.
Yeah. But I guess my point is, if you look at that emotion, I feel there'll be a shift for you.
That's what I want to, so this is perfect. I'm very grateful.
And when you look at these emotions, and all of a sudden you become more conscious of the indications that you're receiving from your spirit friends, your guides in particular, and your guardians, to actually go here, do that, like different places and different things that you engage. and those things will lead you down a track of some kind. And the key is to engage them when you notice them and just go with them generally. And you'll be led down a path, not only in terms of decision. In other words, if you've already decided the path, then you'll be probably not be moving very far, but you still might be dealing with emotions and other things. But like many of you are a little afraid of passing, and there's no need to be afraid of passing either, because actually the process of passing is a lot easier than what most people feel it is, and almost everybody who passes often is not even aware that I've passed. That's how seamless and painless the process is for many people who pass. So, the reality is you don't need to be afraid of passing. You need to just decide where you want to be, what you want to be doing, what's your desire. Does that make sense? That's all we need to do. We can engage a lot of our desires in the spirit world, but remember, in the spirit world there is this limitation, and that is wherever our soul condition is where we're going to arrive. But we're not going to be without help. We're not going to be without assistance. Our spirit friends want to give us assistance. So even if we arrive and we realise, wow, I thought I was in the second sphere, but I'm actually in the hills. Or I hoped I was in the second sphere, but I'm actually in the hills. Then what our spirit friends can help us greatly with that if we know the process, if we long for their assistance and we listen carefully to them and listen to what they're saying, even though we go, oh, I don't know if I get that, we listen to them, then we have the ability to progress. And so we don't need to be concerned about where we're going to be. And this is why I put that question last to a degree. We need to be concerned is where I am engaging my passions and desires right now. Is it? Is where I am right now engaging all of my passions and desires right now? If it's not, then find a place that does. Right? And if it is, then stay there. And feel. And if you feel that, maybe it's not very safe here, maybe I need to find a similar location that's going to engage all my passions and desires, that will be safer. And when you make that choice and decision, you'll be surprised how much your guides are willing to help you go through the process of discovering where you should be.
Your guides are just saying all the time, just engage your passion and desire, just engage your passion and desire, because the minute you do, I can
help you.
Help everything. I can orchestrate it, so you don't even have to realise that you're making a decision about earth changes, but you're in the right place.
You're in the right place at the right time, as the saying goes. If we go back to Enrique again, who started the question.
I wanted to clarify that part of my reason for asking that question, I know part of it's fear and all that stuff, but yeah. I recently had a positive experience where I followed your advice about following desires, and it was just an amazing experience. And like my other desires connected to it like a magnet. And it was such a great experience.
Yeah.
Part of the reason I asked is because I have this huge burning desire to like build earth domes and find ways to do water and electricity differently.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to engage that desire while I'm here, even though I think plan A might be to go to Australia.
Because
the way you guys are doing things there is the way I think they should be done. And I'd like to try it here, but if it's not happening, but I wanted to start now. I have this
part
desire
to begin.
Part of
the problem you face, Enrique, is that you're waiting for other people to do it with you.
Yeah, I know that's the case.
What did you say? Say what you said.
I said that's exactly right.
Exactly.
He's waiting for somebody to start it. It annoys me because I want him to start it because that's what he wants to do.
Yeah, exactly.
And I just feel like so much is holding him down and back. Fear, I guess, is what you want to say.
Yeah.
I'm ready to go. I've been ready to go. Let's go to Australia. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. I'm ready. My bags are packed.
Or even somewhere in the U.S. if you find a place.
Yeah, anywhere. I'm ready to go.
There are very interesting people, too, who are here, actually, in the USA, who are used to doing some of these things.
Yeah.
There is a lot more information and technology available in the USA along these lines than that are available anywhere else in the world.
I guess what was holding me up, and I realize this is error now, is I wanted to know the place so that the work wouldn't be wasted. I could build a mud brick thing in the backyard, but I guess I'm feeling like learning about it would still have value. But I wanted to know the place so we could start making trips and building it up. But
now
I guess
your guides are yelling at me, build it in the backyard then.
Okay.
You start laying the bricks and we'll be able to help more.
Can I illustrate how it happens in Raga? Mm-hmm. What happens is you start building in the backyard and you realise, oh, I don't know how to do this. So you get on the internet and start looking up all the people who know how to do this. And you say, and then you find somebody, and he happens to live in New Mexico. And so what you do is you correspond with him, and he says, oh, come down and look at my stuff that I've done. And I say, yeah, fair enough, you drive down there and have a look at his stuff. And then you go, you have an idea now what to do, but he says, while you're there, he says, do you know, I'm thinking about doing this in the northern part of Mexico on the border with Texas. That's where I'm thinking about doing some of these things because they have less laws there, they have different, less constraints and all that. And would you like to be involved in that process? And you go, oh yeah, that sounds like a good idea, so I'll join in with that. And before you know it, you're led to a place that will have a higher degree of safety than Las Vegas, Nevada.
Yeah, part of what it is I feel is I want to begin it, but I don't feel like the guy that's going to do everything, so I want to find the people. And I have attracted some of them, but it always seemed, so I'm the guy.
Can I say something to every single person, every single person that has this emotion? If I waited for the perfect sound guy to come along before I did a talk, and I waited for the perfect video person to come along to actually present the talk, and if I waited for the sound equipment to be given me by somebody, you know where I would be right now? Well, I'd be sitting in what's called South Australia, in an area called Victor Harbour, 3,000 kilometres away from ever meeting this woman, my girl, and 3,000 kilometres, 4,000 kilometres away from where I live, right? And I would never have met you or anybody else in the world that I have met in the last 7 years.
But you'd be surfing.
An unhappy surfer.
But I wouldn't be engaging all my passions and desires, you see? And this is the problem, is that many of us want the ideal person to come along without action. And it's a major problem that we have.
And our spirit friends have been saying this continually on this trip, like talk to people about the fact that when you start out, it's not going to be perfect. It's going to feel awkward, what's going on? But if you engage this desirous place within you, things will be attracted to you. And often we want to make excuses, like I can't go to, I don't know, what's something on the coast? I can't go to California to find out about my brick because that's not where I'm going to end up, and because that's going to be bad for earth changes. But you don't know that by going to California, it'll take you.
You might meet a person. Takes you somewhere else.
Somewhere else, and then you're in Australia for a while, and then you're back here, and you've got to engage. You've got to know that you're not going to go from I'm in a condition of error, far away from God, to I'm safe and I'm at one with God. It's not a single step, you know. They keep saying, tell them it's going to be like a journey. And that's cool.
Yeah, you've got to be prepared to follow.
Yeah.
And can I say, Enrico, before you comment again, there are many people here in the States with a very amazing technology about, you know, even building things out of rubbish, for example, that are totally self-sustainable, which... when you think about it, how essential is that going to be in this new environment, knowing how to build things out of rubbish, because there's going to be plenty of rubbish around to build things from. And so, you know, we can connect with all of these people if we follow the direction. But if you don't follow the direction and you just wait for the right people to come along, to be frank, it's because you don't want to do it yourself. And to be frank, that's pretty selfish. Right? Mm-hmm. For me to expect Michael to sit there and do the video is a selfish act if I have never done it myself. For me to expect Igor to sit down and make up a DVD and I've never done it myself, that's a selfish act. I don't know what's involved. If I know what's involved, then I can, when other people won't come along to help, and say this is what's involved and give them direction, you see. Very different process. So I feel for most people on the planet, what they're doing, and most people even involved in the divine love community, as the saying goes, are actually waiting for other people to do things for them. Things are not going to happen too well that way. Well, if we all wait for somebody else to do something for us, it's like I'm waiting for Mary, Mary's waiting for Joy. And Joy's waiting for Rita, Rita's waiting for Carol. And so what happens? We all do nothing. And that's the general result, that we all do nothing. if we engage our passion and desire, understanding that we need to learn everything. We need to learn everything ourselves before we can teach it to another person. Then we'll engage every passion that we have with a desire that's really passionate, and we will obviously get information, and in this process get led to different places and locations. Yeah.
I just wanted to add that the one successful experience I had with following my desires involved action 100%.
Yeah.
And it was the opposite of what I'd always done, which is just talk about things and wait for people.
Yeah.
This involved taking action, and then it was just amazing how other desires were attracted to
things,
that.
When you take action, things happen in moments rather than days, weeks, or months. When you don't take action and you talk about it, like I've heard you talk about this, for now, what would it be? Close to 3 years? Yes. Wife is handing up. How long has it been? And yet no action. So you've got to look at your fear of taking action. There's a fear of taking action. And also a bit of anger in taking action. A feeling that you want other people to do it. And this is why we raised some of the things yesterday. You see, there is demand in this, where we just sit down waiting for other people to take action. There's a demand in that other people satisfy my passions and desires. And that's never a good thing. Ever a good thing. Yeah. Very good question.
Just as part of the where it's safe in the United States, we talked about it really briefly in Greece, and you mentioned northern New York, that area.
The area right up the top here with the border of Canada may be relatively safe. But you've got... still got events from the coast, so you have to be over the ranges. So relatively safe, but not, you know, it depends on, like I said, the degree of number four that you want, comfort that you want in the process. Yeah.
Hi, I just wanted to recommend a movie along the line of movies that I watched the other night. It's called Take Shelter. And it basically ties in with the Archangel Michael channeling, in that it's the process of a man who feels something is coming, but he thinks he's going insane, and how the community around him doesn't support him in it. And it's a good one.
Yep, sounds good.
Yeah.
One of the major impediments we have of changing our life is what other people will think of us.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised how much we don't change our own life because of what other people might think of us. It's a big impediment. Someone down here?
So what if you feel like the stuff that you're passionate about basically won't be helpful at all?
Lawyer...
That's probably not going to be that. But what are your passions?
Well, photography is my biggest one.
And why would that be available?
I just don't see how that can... I don't know. I just...
Can you see, we're automatically, oftentimes when we have these discussions, people automatically go, oh, if there's no power, there's no this, there's no that.
It's actually, in the past 6 months, I've been led to learn. Like, I started on film, and I traded over to digital.
Mm-hmm.
But the last 6 months, I've completely switched back, mm-hmm. and I've been doing film, and I've been learning different ways to develop. And I even have developed pictures with coffee.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing, mm-hmm. and just vitamin C. But
so you're already being led along. So why are you confused?
Because I don't know. I think the thing that I struggle with about my passion is that I don't really see how does it do anything for anyone?
She has a fear about being...
Number one, your passions are not about anybody else, ever. They're about you. And when you engage your passion, that's when you're happy, right? When you're happy, everyone around you feels your happiness. They're not feeling your sadness, they're not feeling your fears, they're not feeling all the other things.
They're actually feeling you.
They're feeling you.
This is the God created, this passionate person who's full of creativity. That's in expression.
That has a desire in a certain area.
Yeah.
Follow those desires in a certain area. You'll be surprised how these desires will help everyone. Many of you are going to be very surprised that some of your desires that you think, oh, you know, no, you're going to want that, you know, and how later they will help all sorts of people through following these desires.
I actually don't believe that God created us with a passion that doesn't serve humanity when we fully embrace it.
Yeah. But we don't necessarily know when we embrace it how it serves humanity.
Yeah.
Yes.
You'll discover it in the process. You need to let yourself go through the process.
Okay.
So engage the passion fully. It sounds like you already are. Like, we have a friend in Australia who wanted to make shoes.
They're awesome. I've got to put them on the blog.
Yeah, she's actually made her husband a pair of shoes.
Go tell the story. I'll skip to the end.
No. Mary skips to the end because the end is quite good. But she had no idea how to make shoes at all.
But she loves shoes, and she's a
shoes.
Vegan now. So
how many of you girls love shoes? Okay, no worries. Well, she was the same, you see. Right? Loves shoes, you know, loves the creativity in it and the design of it and all those kind of things, as many women do. Right? And so she decided that she wanted to bring shoes into harmony with love as well, because most of them are leather and, you know, have a lot of very toxic processes involved in making them, plus killing a few animals in the process. So what she decided to do was try to discover how to actually build vegan shoes. Shoes that, from scratch, by hand. She realised that there probably wouldn't be power in the future, so she firstly decided to try and find a mechanised sewing machine.
A treadle-based
sewing machine, so that she could sew them. She found one here in the States. We don't have them in Australia, but you have them here. In fact,
I sent it to her.
Yeah. Does that make sense? So she found through this process where it was, found out how to get it, all these other things that comes to her. And she found also there were some that she discovered in Australia that were 50 years or 60 years old, and they come along with a lot of the needles and all these different things for sewing leather and all these other things. And then there's this lady down in Tasmania, which is like 3,500 kilometres from where she is, or 3,000 kilometres from where she is, who normally never leaves Tasmania. And our friend has 3 children under 6. I think it's under 6.
Under
5.
4 almost.
Yeah. 3 children under 5, right? So can you imagine having to go to Tasmania and do lots of work? So she says, I really would like her to come and visit me. Right?
Well, actually, she finally arranged it. In 4 years, she hasn't been anywhere because they live on Sheep Station and she's been having kids. And she finally arranged for it to happen, and a volcano went off in New Zealand.
Yeah.
So her flight was cancelled.
Was cancelled.
For the next 3 days, and she couldn't go to the workshop. So she had to process a lot of feelings about that.
So there's all these impediments to her desire coming up all the time, of course, which is a part of the refinement process that we get put through. And then, anyway, it turns out that the lady eventually came and stayed on her own property and taught her how to make shoes.
In a one-on-one workshop rather than 1-on-5 or something.
Yeah. And so now she's making these shoes. She's taken our, what do you call them? There's a name for it.
Last.
She's taken our last, which is the shape of your foot, and she does each shoe individually. So the shoe is perfectly fit. Her husband wears a pair of these shoes. They look awesome. And I've actually ordered a pair of spats, very colourful ones from her. And so she's now actually making these shoes where people are ordering some of these shoes from her and so forth. Yeah.
What does she make them out of?
She's experimenting with all sorts of materials at this point in time. Some of the materials are what you call...
It's like the first ones were out of upholstery, like what you cover your couch with, but like a thick sort of...
Canvas?
It looks almost suede-ish.
Yeah. But she's also been experimenting with wool.
Well,
they
have
also
a sheep
have sheep farm.
So she wants to make them out of felt eventually.
Yeah, so the whole shoe out of felt. With her soul, that you know, and so forth.
Old car tyres she wants to use for the.
She wants to use old car tyres for the soul.
Oh well, this changes the topic a little bit.
Sure.
It's okay. It's just funny that this segues into a question that I was thinking of asking, and it kind of changes how I want to ask it. But, I've been thinking about how to be. We're fairly self-sufficient.
Yeah.
We make our own shoes, not these, but,
yeah.
And grow our own food. And I have this emotion like. I think it has a couple of aspects that I can see is that I feel like the world is so degraded and we're so degraded that it's hard to find loving options. I feel like I'm often choosing between the least of evils. And I think it also has to do with feeling like an emotion that there is conflict between love of self and love of others, that those can come into conflict. And
I answer? Because if I don't answer it, then I'll forget. And firstly, we want to address this issue, the feeling that you have that the world's not a very loving place with very loving options. That is a feeling you have. Please don't, what you're doing in your life is you're transmitting that across to a fact. You're actually believing it's a fact. Now, if we address the feeling, if we release the feeling, you'll find that you'll attract loving people with a lot of loving options. Does that make sense?
It makes sense, because I was actually thinking about footwear, yeah? And how Peter makes shoes, but they're made of leather. And I don't know what else I would make shoes for myself out of, except for, we have yucca that the native people made it from, but that doesn't seem practical for us. So I've thought, it seems like, oh, there's nothing else I can do. You know, I feel kind of helpless. Like, this is all we know how to do and all we're able to do. And in our garden, we grow our own food, which I think is great, but we use manure that comes from a dairy that isn't very loving. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what else we would do, yeah. You know? So.
And you will find, when you release this emotion that the world's not very loving and that we can't find out about these things, when you release that, you start attracting people who know about these things.
Right, well, it's already happened. So.
Yeah, exactly. So with myself and Mary, for example, we rarely, if ever, use manure. Because we're experimenting with other forms of composting and other forms of production of nutrients for gardens. And we've got all sorts of experiments on the way as a result of that. And now the different teams in Australia are starting to embrace those particular experiments and are experimenting with all these different forms that we can use. Because in the long run, I feel in the short term, there will be many animals that pass in this process, the same as people, and so we will be able to use their felt or their and so forth, their skins afterwards. We haven't killed them, but we need to utilise what is available to us. But in the long run, if we want to bring everything into a lot of harmony with love, we need to understand how to do things differently. And there are many people on the planet who know how to do things. It's just most of them are connecting with each other because of the different emotions that cause a blockage between their connections. If we deal with the emotion, we automatically embrace, like the people, this person tells us about that person, tells us about this person. When we follow the desire, we find them, and all of a sudden all the information comes as a result of that connection. And that's the beautiful thing about following our desire, and also following our desire without disillusionment and hopelessness. Many of us do have a feeling of hopelessness and disillusionment about the world, and we don't realise that that feeling creates its own problems. It creates its own attractions, where we are always disillusioned and we always feel hopeless. And until we actually embrace the emotion and feel through the emotion and release it, it will keep attracting the same kinds of events. Once you release it, now more hopeful things will happen, and you'll feel less disillusionment as a result. Is it?
Oh, that sounds wonderful.
Yeah. So many of the people we know who we've been talking to around the world, and particularly in Australia, many people are starting to embrace their passions, immaterial of what myself and Mary are doing. So what we see our role as really is just talking about the divine truth and trying to be an example of it so that other people can see that it's a real, it causes changes. And once we become at one with God, that will be demonstrated, I feel, very well. We don't see our role as providing every solution to every problem on the planet. What we see is that the planet is full of people who have very, very good intellects and ideas and imagination and the will to carry it out. So what we're trying to do is encourage people to grasp hold of those desires and passions that are within them already, and build those passions and desires to a place where they are actually feeling completely like they are the creators of these particular things. And I just feel quite strongly that actually most people have... God's designed us in such a way that all of us have a unique ability to fit in with other people if we follow our passions and desires. It's when we don't follow our passions and desires that everything gets confused. And every single one of you has a passion and desire. Our primary ones, and then a lot of secondary ones. Right? And if you follow them all, you'll be fascinated with what happens. Yeah? Life is very interesting, but also you'll learn a lot and you'll connect with people who know this, know that, and so forth.
And this is what I was saying earlier about I don't believe that God gave us a passion that isn't going to serve humanity in some way. Just that, like you said, we don't always know in the immediate moment how that's going to happen. But if you imagine everyone in this room suddenly embracing their passion in a state of love, the amount of gifts that would pass between each of you would be phenomenal.
Yeah, multiply.
I just wanted to say that for most of my life, I feel as if I've been preparing for earth changes, and maybe based out of fear for years and years, I've been hearing channelings that they were coming, and I've always tended to be as self-sufficient as I could. I have a big garden and a lot of fruit trees, and my thoughts are disappearing.
But how have you gone with the desire?
But now when I feel like I really need to be paying attention to these things, it's that I don't have the desire to do that anymore.
Exactly.
It's completely left me. I don't want a garden, and I just feel like I want to get in a camper van and go travel and enjoy nature. And so that seems so contrary to... And plus, I live on the coast in California, too. I haven't set myself up in the best location.
Well, so. I find that's very interesting a lot of the times, too, how we often, because fear guides some of our actions, we're not very open to inspiration, right? And in the place, we decide, I'm going to become self-sufficient. I'll plant some trees, and I'll do this, and I'll do that, and I'll plant plants, and I'll get everything happening, and it happens to be in a place that's the worst possible place to do it, because we're afraid, you see?
Yeah.
And so all of that work that we've done, in the end of the day, is not going to result in anything, because our fear attracted us to this place. Now, when you engage your desire...
Well, actually, okay, if you look at it now, so for how long have you been doing this, looking after yourself, taking personal responsibility?
Oh, gosh, since my 20s.
So...
I'm tired of it.
Quite a few years. So, obviously, a few errors in there, but... Yeah. If you think about it, what
for you
kind
to be
of...
tired of it, can yeah. I point out, there has yeah. to be fear generating the reason to do it in the first place.
Because when we love
it. If it's a passion, you're never tired of it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. But if you look at your life right now, you have years and years of amassed skills in how to do this.
I do.
And right now your desire is, I don't want to be here, I want to get in a camper van and travel yeah. around. So those two things don't seem that negative to me. They seem here's a woman with a lot of skills and knowledge she could even impart to others, but also wherever she lands, she has a lot of skills with her.
Mm-hmm.
And she's her main desire that she can connect to is to leave the place that is probably pretty dangerous and go exploring.
Yes.
You know, so.
But my partner doesn't want to go, and I still would like to be in my marriage.
So can you see how an emotion now is interfering with your desire?
Yes.
An emotion of connectedness to somebody who is actually holding you in the same place.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where I find, like, I've had to exercise my desire very frequently that Mary is totally in disagreement.
Really?
Oh. Totally in disagreement. Like, if I followed Mary's desires rather than my own, what would be happening right now?
Yeah,
we'll
probably have a veggie garden.
Oh. Have a veggie garden.
We've been home in Queensland. Mm-hmm. I would never have met you guys, and there'd be no probably anything on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because everything I put on YouTube confronts Mary because she gets scared every time something gets
put
on there.
I see.
Yeah. There'd be DVDs. Mm-hmm. Maybe you'd have to be posting. Mike would be working hard on his burner. But truthfully, if we let my fear guide this relationship,
mm-hmm.
I doubt if most of you would have even, you know, heard of divine truth, your relationship with God wouldn't have started. So there has to be a decision in our relationship where my fear is not going to dominate what happens.
So what I said to Mary was, I said, look, I love you, darling, but your fear holds back our soul. And so I can't respond to your fear anymore. I've got to respond to what I feel our desires are, the true desires of our soul. And so I'm going to embrace that. And if you're angry with me about that, then be angry about it. If you're sad about it, be sad about it. If you want to leave me, leave me, if that's what you want. Mm-hmm. And as a result, there's been turmoil in our relationship while we've worked through those issues. And I have a desire to be with Mary in the end, and Mary...
has a
desire. But she hasn't always felt that way, right? Yeah. And so, you know, this is something to be aware of when you're in a relationship, is that you can't always follow your own desire and satisfy the desire of the other person, particularly if the desire of the other person is based on fear or suppressing your desire. The beauty, though, of a relationship is that if one person follows their desire, so this person here follows their desire in this direction, love will generally, if the person stays in harmony with love and is not acting out of fear, love will pull this person along with it, generally, without there being any pressure. Right? So changes will occur naturally through the process. But it does require both parties to be very sincere of working through the particular problems that they have in terms of their own desires and passions, but also in terms of their relationship. So our relationship has been confronted very frequently through this process. Yes.
Because AJ is very much in harmony with love and truth on just about every issue,
yes.
And when I met him, and probably still, I'm in a lot of error on just about every issue because fear has dominated my life. So
I don't even see Mary like she's just described. I just see Mary as I can feel all of her passions and desires in her soul, but I can feel this very, very heavy layer of fear,
mm-hmm.
right? And this very heavy layer of fear, I don't want it to dominate our relationship. Now, if that means that Mary wants to leave me because I don't want it, then I'm okay with that. As I said in our previous discussion, I'm not evil, so I don't want to control her or manipulate her or anything like that into staying with me just because she doesn't like what I'm doing. But that being said, I also want to say, I've also had to say to Mary, no, I'm sorry, I'm not going to listen to this fear of yours anymore. This fear of yours prevents us from actually embracing our life. So I've had to confront the fear that she has and confront my own fear of displeasing her, yes. as well.
And can I say, as the other party, that has been very confronting for me, and I have been angry at times. But the this truth that AJ states, I'm testament to that truth. because he's moving in a direction of love. It is incredibly magnetic to me. And also, I've got so much gratitude now that I have met all of you, that I am standing here doing something that I'm so passionate about. But I didn't really come willingly in the beginning. You know,
kicking and screaming.
He wasn't pulling me, love was, but I was really, you know.
And I kept saying to Mary, you don't have to be here, darling. You don't have to be here. You
and
don't like it.
I get this huffy attitude of like, I don't want to be, but I can't ignore it. So I'm going to have to confront this horrible fear or whatever it is.
Yeah.
So, you know, I would say that to anyone with a partner who is perhaps more fearful or more resistive. There's going to have to be confrontation of that at some point, and it might not always go really smoothly, but if you want love and want to go in that direction, that is, for me personally, has been incredibly attractive.
So all the way through this transition, my feelings towards Mary pretty much haven't changed, in the sense that I love her, I reassure her that I love her, however, and my actions prove that I love her as well, but I'm not going to pander to the fear that's present.
Because if I do that, then both of us go stagnant. Both of us finish up not growing. And I can't have both of us not growing because I want to be closer to God. And even if Mary doesn't want to be, I do want to be.
And also what you've said to me, you want to be closer to me. And when I live in my fear, he can't be close to
me. It's like, fear is like, I think I've likened it in Australia to a condom. But it's like a covering.
This is the point where you say, don't visualise it.
Have you seen Naked Gun? Have any of you seen Naked Gun? But it's like you're trying to touch the person or hold the person or interact with the person through a layer. And the fear is the layer that you're trying to connect through. And while you're always trying to overcome the layer, you can't be close.
I don't know if you've experienced that. Living in fear, it feels the same from the inside out for me. It
feels like a layer. Too.
I want to connect to you, but I'm so afraid that nothing, I can't even feel anything properly.
Yeah. And these fears can only be confronted by action. So this is the beauty of recognising a desire, acting upon it. Fear gets confronted, then things come up and we resolve them. If we love each other, we will continue to resolve them. We will continue to act lovingly towards each other without damaging each other. Now, if the other person is not on the divine path even, you can just say to them, look, I love you. I don't want to be constrained, though, by your fear. Right? Mm-hmm. And so I love you, and I'm not going to leave you and go with anybody else because I love you. Like, you meet soulmate, you're never going to want to go anywhere else, right? But...
maybe not always.
No, maybe not all of us. But you don't feel like you want to do anything else with any other person. However, you also need to fully embrace your collective soul's passions and desires. And if your other half is having a fear about that, then you need to confront their fear about that. You need to say, no, this is not right. This is not also not loving, by the way, for me to just live in your fear all the time. And when you appeal to their love that's in them, it's very often the case that both of you finish up growing. What I see, though, a lot of people going, and some in Australia, unfortunately, have done this quite a number in Australia have done this. I'm not saying a large amount, but they sort of go like, oh, you don't have my passions and desires. Well, you can go then. That's what they do. And they just go and find another person who they believe has their passions and desires. Now, I would say to those people, you are not being loving. Do you love this person or not? You know, is this person important to you or not? If they're important to you, you won't just push them away the instant they don't give you what you want. However, you will also confront the fear that's within them about it. You won't just passively accept the state that everything is in. So what we'd like to encourage you to do, if you are in a relationship where one half is not engaged with the passion and desire, is to appeal, firstly, to their sense of reason about that issue. The second thing is appeal to their sense of love about the issue. Do they actually love? And are they interested in growth or are they wanting stagnation? Now, don't allow, even if the other person is your other soul half, don't allow your other soul half to stop you from growing, ever. Because the beauty is if you continue to grow, in love in particular, the other soul half will feel more attracted to you. So if you stop the growth, you're going to be stagnant in the level of attraction you feel for each other as well. That's the problem.
It's very attractive to see the other half of your soul fully embracing something that, even though you might be afraid of it or it's squashed down there, that you really want inside of yourself as well.
Yeah. Because remember, if it's the other half of your soul, this person, then they will eventually, because there is the seed of the same passion and desire within them. That's part of our personality. So once you see myself and Mary, you know, we're Mary without as much fear, you'll see that our passions and desires match very, very closely. Perfectly, in fact. Yeah. And that's what happens. When the more you embrace your passion and desire, the more you realise that, the other half of you is just
exactly that, the other half of you, like, has exactly the same kind of passions and desires. Love will always attempt to bind together, but it never sacrifices love of each other or itself to do so. So in other words, you would never sacrifice love of yourself in order to stay together, and you would never sacrifice love of the other person in order to leave them. Do you see? Like, love is a binding force in all cases. So,
oh, yes.
Yeah. And so it's important to understand that when we're in a relationship, and if we truly love each other, I will not stop Mary from following her passions and desires, even if they are in error. Or I believe they're in error. And Mary will not stop me following my passions and desires, even if my passions and desires are in error, or she believes they're in error. However, she won't automatically go, I agree and I'm going to come along with you, yeah, if she believes that. And if she stays firm to her passions and desires and stays firm to the principles of love and truth, we will work out those issues quite rapidly, in fact. If we're really passionate about it, we will get through them within weeks, not years. Right? What happens with most relationships is they do not want to confront the disparity in passions and desires, or one person talks about things a lot, does not act, or the other person's always wanting to hold back because of their fear, or whatever it is that's causing it. And so what that does is it creates a barrier in the relationship automatically. There's automatically a barrier in the relationship. And that barrier is not loving. Like, if we desired to change it, we would desire to embrace each other, not desire to go apart. So it's very important in a relationship to never let go of your passion and desire, never let go of your true nature and your true personality, but also live in harmony with love with the other person, no matter what their condition. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Yeah. That's really helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah. So in my case, I don't think I know what my passions and desires are. I mean,
yeah,
I feel like I get excited about something and do it for a while and then,
yeah,
feel like I'm done.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, that's happened in the past few years.
Yeah.
And so now in this conversation, I'm realizing, I bet I don't even know what they are.
So how do you go about working out what they are?
Well, praying to God is...
Well, actually, I just gave a talk in Greece about that a few weeks ago.
Okay.
So, and in that talk, I listed four or five things that can be done,
okay,
to discover your passions,
yeah,
and desires. And they're all very simple things that anybody can do. Don't try to force it.
Yeah.
But also allow yourself to discover them. You see, what happens in our life is we're often shutting down passion and desire because we're trying to conform,
mm-hmm,
to what other people want us to do or whatever,
mm-hmm,
what society wants us to do. And in that process, we sort of lose ourselves. And to be with God, you have to be yourself. You can't be somebody else other than yourself.
Right.
And that is all about discovering what you desire, what, right, you really want to do. So my feelings are, the very first thing you do before you decide anything else is go through the process of discovering what you really like doing. Yeah. So don't need to do anything else, you don't need to move anywhere, you don't need to go anywhere, you need to work through the process of discovering, and I've outlined that process in previous talks, and particularly the talk that I gave in Greece.
Is that on the net yet, does it sound
fun? I don't think
not
so.
Not as of about 5 days ago.
No, I don't
the
think it is. Because we only just came
yeah,
from Greece to
yeah,
here, so...
We just did it on the 12th or something.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Okay, so it will be coming up...
Yeah, pretty soon either. Mm-hmm. It might come up this week if I get a chance to work on it in my motel room, but if not, then it will be when we get back home, probably.
Okay.
Yeah, which is 2 weeks
mm-hmm,
away.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have, for many, many years now, been having dreams. And some of those dreams have come true.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if those dreams are fear,
yeah,
or they're really something, or somebody's trying to tell me something.
Mm-hmm.
Then last night, when we were all opening our fortune cookie, my fortune cookie said, a dream you'll have will come true. So now I'm like, whoa, are you really trying to tell me something here?
So what were the dreams, do you mind?
I dreamt the night before, or the morning before, I dreamt 9/11.
Yeah.
I dreamt just planes crashing into buildings.
Yeah.
Like a few weeks later, another plane crashed into Lake Holmes. I dreamt that.
Yeah.
And a FedEx plane crashing into the ocean. I dreamt that.
Yeah.
And I dreamt like tsunamis were gonna happen. So a lot of stuff I dream comes true.
Yeah.
Eventually.
Yeah.
Not necessarily like the day before, the night before, but.
Yeah.
I just feel like sometimes a lot of my dreams are trying to warn me.
Yes.
But I don't know if they're just, I'm scared of flying. I'm scared of tsunamis. So it's like, am I really like, is that my fears or is that something trying to tell me something?
Well, what I would do firstly is allow yourself to feel your fear of flying, allow yourself to feel the fear of tsunamis, get a movie or two about a plane crashing and connect with...
I've been doing that a lot.
Okay. So generally when we have fears like that, they are related to our childhood in some way. And this is what most of us don't do, is we don't connect it to our mum and dad's emotions in a particular situation, which is usually always about the withdrawal of love. So one of our primary fears are all about the withdrawal of love in a particular situation. So that tells me that something's happened in your childhood, something traumatic to your family, perhaps, that you need to ask yourself about, or ask them about, perhaps if they're still alive. That will help you connect with the withdrawal of love to those particular events. When you connect those two particular things, you'll find you'll relieve, you'll grieve something, and in the process of grieving it, you'll no longer have a terror of that particular event. But, that all being said, many people on the planet are nightly having dreams about Earth change events now. So, you know, we meet people all over the world, from all walks of life, who have never heard us talk ever before, and who have never talked to any person who's about New Age or Earth Changers, and you ask them what they dream, they go, oh, last night I dreamt this, and the night before I dreamt that, and so on. And almost all of the themes are common in the sense they're all talking about very large Earth-based events occurring on the planet. Now that tells me that in our sleep state, we are very conscious of events that are going to occur, and all we need to do is allow ourselves to be conscious of it in our awake state. I feel they are all indications that yes, these events are coming, and we do need to follow desires and passions, and we'll be led to the right location as to where we want to be. Even if that location happens to be a place where we die very quickly and pass over, because that's where we want to be.
Have you tried using this in a more purposeful way, conscious way, like asking a question before you go to sleep?
I did once. Nothing. I don't remember. Sometimes I just don't remember my dreams sometimes when I wake up. I don't know if I don't want to remember them, probably, most likely.
The problem you have emotionally is that it freaks you out that you know events before they occur.
It does freak me.
Yeah.
It freaks me out so much.
What you've got to do is address the emotion as to why it freaks you out, because it's not a bad thing to know.
I don't want to know, though.
Why?
I don't know.
Exactly.
Because often your guides give you some of these visions to let you know you have a gift. Mm-hmm. They say, okay, let's give her a dream about the FedEx plane crashing. Then she'll see it on the news and go, oh, wow. Well, maybe there's something there, you know. And so that's why I said...
I feel really hot right now.
Yeah. Well, I feel that you're a bit afraid.
You're afraid.
You're totally, as you said, freaked out about having this gift.
Mm. Yeah.
But if you could work through that...
Can I suggest some reasons why you're afraid of having the gift?
I've always felt like I don't want to know the future. I just want to live day by day and just enjoy it. So, like, I don't know.
Your dreams are telling you totally opposite of that.
I know.
So you can't really assume that that's real.
I feel like if I know the dream, I want to go and like save everybody.
So you feel responsible.
One emotion. Okay. One very big emotion actually that you have, that you need to let yourself work through, of responsibility.
Well, yeah, I helped my family raise 4 kids, so it's like, I feel like I'm responsible for everybody. Like, I wanted to clean up yesterday, and I wanted to go upstairs and cook, and like, you know, it's like, I feel like I'm the mother. I have to do everything for everybody.
And that's the emotion that causes you to not want to know future events.
A lot of people with that gift have the same feeling.
Same,
like, if I know, I'm responsible for it happening, or preventing it happening, and all of those things.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, it actually... actually shuts down the gift a lot. And because of that horrible gut-wrenching feeling you have, it actually shuts down your ability to help people more.
Yeah.
Do you understand?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
So the answer is to embrace these desires and abilities, but deal with the emotion that causes you to feel scared about it.
Because, I mean, I've flown already. I've flown a couple times. I go to the ocean. I swim in the water. So it's not like I won't do it, but it's just I still feel like that fear.
Yeah. But I feel the fear is not about flying.
It's not. I know it's not.
It's not about the ocean. It's about this fear that you have that your life won't be your own if you know about events and then feel like you've got to save people. Yeah.
Have there's a movie about this too.
There's a recent Hollywood movie.
It's even got a tsunami in it. What's has
awesome
anyone seen
movie,
it?
Hereafter.
Yeah. Oh, okay, yeah, I've seen it, yeah.
You've seen that?
Yeah,
watch that again. Because you need to connect with some of those feelings and let yourself feel it. What is the time, by the way?
It's 5.
Yeah, I feel I'm pretty tired now, so I've been talking 7 hours. So I'm sorry for those of you who want to continue asking questions. I understand that what you feel, but I've probably got to stop. Considering there might be dinner where I'll be talking a bit too. We would just love to thank you guys for your attention over the last 2 days. And we'd love to thank you too for your donations that you've given to us too over the last 2 days. It's helped pay pretty much at least half of our expenses at this point, so of coming here. And Robin and her family would like to thank because they pay for our flight to get here.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So that we'd
thank
like
you
to thank them. And have you enjoyed?
Absolutely. I've loved coming to the States. Great. And you're all delightful. It's really beautiful. Thank you for the gift of your presence and your openness and warmth. It's been beautiful. Yeah.
Most of us love Aussies.
most Americans love Aussies. Except when the Aussie confronts them emotionally. But we're from here going back to the UK. So that happens on Wednesday. And then in the UK, we'll just be giving one talk there in the UK before we go home. So we'll be going home next Monday, actually. Not this Monday, but the following Monday, and back to Australia. Now, all of the people in Australia, many of whom you've seen on movies,
on
YouTube or whatever, have asked us to give you their love and
to
remind you
that
they're thinking about you so we'd like to pass that on to you guys. And
we love them.
We're in gratitude for all that they've shared in all of those videos.
Are they brave?
Oh, my gosh.
Many of them are so brave. Eh? It's like some of the things they come out with, you go, what? it just shows you that. And what we find very endearing with people is that once they get into a state where they desire truth and they're open and truthful about themselves, we just find that so overwhelmingly endearing. And so many of the people we meet around the world become like, we think about all of the people we meet generally quite often. And we would just like to encourage you guys to also realise that you're not alone.
Mm-hmm.
You know that there are beautiful spirit friends with you every single moment of your day. There is your guide and your guardian with you every single moment of the day, trying to assist you through your life. And there are also many people around the world who think of you, right? And many people pray for you. Pray for other people on the Divine Love Path to help them go through different things. And there's many people in Australia who have been praying specifically for their brothers and sisters in the US, realizing that there will be, you know, difficult times ahead in most countries, in a lot of countries of the planet, your country being one. And they pray that you become ready for such things emotionally.
And so we would like to also add to their prayer and hope that you also become ready for these things emotionally. The physical readiness will be a byproduct of the emotional readiness. So if you can become ready emotionally, this is a wonderful thing. And hopefully you've enjoyed the company of each other in this process, getting to know each other a little. And for those of you sticking around tonight, we look forward to catching up with you in an hour's time down at the...
Lava tent,
yeah.
Lava, like as in
volcano.
I think it's in like volcano. Lava tent. Yeah. And it might be appropriate. And also we'll get a bit of chance to talk there as well and discuss things hopefully together, depending on how busy the restaurant is. We would like to take the love of you guys back to England, to the people in England, if you would like to do that as well, because we're seeing them once again on the way home.
And what I find so exciting about these trips now that it's all videoed, and I know it's quite confronting for some people, but you know that feeling you have about everyone at home, you've seen them over there asking the questions in the terminal. Well, they now, so many people, like in England, in Sweden, and here, you get to know each other, even if it's just through the movie on YouTube. And that's like a little extra connection that you get to make, and I think it's lovely.
And a lot of these people have information and knowledge that they can share with you.
Yeah.
Like information and knowledge that myself and Mary are not privy to because we haven't had the opportunity to discuss things with them and interact with them on a personal basis, perhaps, about those subjects. And once you follow your passions and desires, you'll discover these people who have very similar passions and desires. You want to work together with them. And we see that as a really positive thing going on.
Rita and Joy have been with us. They live in Australia and they've been with us on each leg. And how have you guys found it?
Oh, it's been wonderful.
Yeah.
It's been wonderful meeting everybody. I haven't had a chance to talk to everybody here.
And I learned a lot about my emotions and about truth and desires.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't have learned it if I would have stayed at home.
Rita's...
And I had lots of fears to work through.
Yeah.
I was very often lonely in my hotel room for days.
And many people don't realise, but Rita has a Down syndrome child at home that she has to care for as well, and lots of different responsibilities, and so it was quite confronting for you even to consider coming away for
a while. But it worked all out very miraculously.
Yeah.
Which I wouldn't have ever thought it would happen a year ago before I went on the Divine Love Path. So I had big changes in myself and with my daughter reflecting me.
Yeah.
So it was amazing.
That's good. Anyway, my verse is now running out, so I'll let you take it. Oh, yes, who of you would like a group picture to be taken? So shall we arrange something up the front here?
Although, could you just go that way?
And everyone kind of glances that way.
Okay.
If everybody comes in together. But you want to see everyone's face, don't you?
If you guys want to...
Have you got a decent camera, Mike?
My battery died.
And Frank has one.